Hi, I'm Julia, and welcome to Up for Discussion. Today's theme is the comeback. I could not be happier than when I get to tell the story of somebody who's turned their life around, somebody whose life was going to go one way, perhaps not a very healthy way, and they say, no, I get to say how it's going to go, and my life's going to go a different way. So my guest today is Mr. Angel Gavilanes, a very dear friend of mine, whom I love. So Angel, tell them, start at the beginning, tell us a little about your story.
Okay, so I guess let's see how far back I can go.
Well, first, let me back up. Uh-huh. So you were arrested for distributing and manufacturing controlled substances. You did 14 months in prison.
Correct.
And since then, you've totally turned your life around. And what you do is you work with people coming out of the prison system to help them get jobs, get their license, what have you.
Correct.
So let's start at the beginning. Tell me, okay. and you grew up in the Bronx, and you grew up in Miami and different places. So what was it about that world that drew you into it? How old were you?
So I'll go back to, what if I went back to my childhood?
Go ahead.
And so I recall being very young, and my mother had a substance abuse issue. She was an alcoholic, and I remember seeing her actually do drugs when I was younger. So in a way, it was like kind of normal.
What kind of drugs?
Cocaine and alcohol. Mm. And so for me, it was kind of a normal thing. Mm-hmm. It wasn't like a bad thing. Mm-hmm. So as I got older, and I was about, I would say about 14 years old, this is when I first got introduced into the drug game. Mm-hmm. And I would see that the older guys that I used to hang out with at the time, they sold drugs. They had money, mm-hmm. they had nice clothes, nice cars, and this is something that I wanted. So they said, so let's show you how we make money. Mm-hmm. And I said, okay.
So let me back. So you're 14, you can't get a regular job because you're not old enough yet.
Right.
And you wanted money.
Right.
So keep going.
So I want money, I can't get a job. Yeah. And so I'm like, well, how else is someone supposed to get nice clothes? And mm-hmm. and I'm like, you know, I was angry at the system for that. I was like, how is somebody supposed to make money? And I was just like, you know what, I'm just gonna make money however I can. And so I went with them, and they took me to a crack spot in Washington Heights. Mm-hmm. And you know, at that time I was trying to prove my loyalty, prove how much of a man I am. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I was acting like I wasn't scared, and I was just going with it, and they mm-hmm. took me to a crack spot, and I was just watching people coming in buying crack.
What did this place look like?
It looked like a crack spot.
What does that no. look like? I've never been in a crack spot.
No, I know. How does it look? Broken up furniture. At that time, it was, we had like Super Nintendo. They were playing Nintendo while they're selling crack. Mm-hmm. They have a sink. I remember it smelling like roach spray.
Okay.
And they told me that's what it smells like when they cook crack, mm-hmm. when they cook coke to make crack. And mm-hmm. I remember smelling that. It was very distinct smell. Mm-hmm. And they had a crate, which is like a signature drug dealing thing. So they had the crate, they had the scales, and that's pretty much an old TV.
So, okay, so that's
broken locks.
Broken locks. I imagine like a burned out building or something, but that's just, well, maybe I've watched too many TV shows.
Well, it's kind of like that.
It's kind of like that.
And can I tell you when I first walked in?
Yeah.
I remember clearly when I first walked into the building, there were some steps missing. It was like a wooden staircase, hmm. broken steps. You have to like wash your step. You literally could, your foot can go through the hole and. Hmm. It was just like, it felt like it was going to break apart.
Yeah. So they say, here's what you're going to do. Do you watch? And then how does that work?
I'm just watching, hanging out, and I'm like, listen, I want to do this. I want to learn how to make money. And they're like, okay, you ready? And I said, yeah. And of course, I didn't want to ask them. So, you know, tell me how to do this again. I was just like, I'm just going to go in here and do it. And they had a regular scale and a broken scale. Broken scale was obviously to make it seem like there was more weight, more drugs, yeah. to make more money.
Yeah.
And so I just, an addict came in And I said, how much do you want? And mm-hmm. that was it. And I just got him the drugs, put it on the scale. I said, here it is. Where's the money? He gave me the money, and that's it.
That was it.
And that was the first time, and that was the start to my drug dealing career, I guess you can say.
And how long were you doing that? How long did it take you to move up?
You mean like how long before I got really heavy into selling drugs?
Yeah, because you also had, you eventually started working a legitimate job.
Right.
Paint me that picture.
So I knew that I always had this in my mind, like I can use this, the skill of making money illegally if I ever needed it to. However, I always felt like I wanted to do things the right way and make an attempt to do it that way.
Yeah.
And I did. I went to school. I did really well. I got a scholarship for art, and I went to college, and I got a good job as a customer service rep. My first job was a customer service rep or call center representative.
Yeah. So you're living a double life.
Yeah, I guess you could say.
Yeah. So at first, it was, what was the experience like? Was it fun? Were you paranoid? How was it?
At first. Selling drugs?
Yes, and that being that lifestyle.
What can I?
You mentioned something before when we spoke before that you said you got into it to make money, but actually you didn't make much money, or
right,
not
first,
not well, what you thought it was.
Right. Well, can I go back a little
sure,
bit?
Sure.
Because something just came to mind. I remember when I was about 14 and I started. What I missed was that people used to ask for marijuana, and I always happened to know someone to get marijuana, so I would go on my bike and literally deliver marijuana. That's actually how it first started. And people would give me a couple dollars here. So that's how I started to get to know the drug dealers, the bigger drug dealers, and when I was younger. Aside from the people I was hanging out with, I was also known in the neighborhood for that I can get people, mostly the older guys, the older men, some getting them marijuana. And anyway, the feeling that I had and the thought that I had was just like, I'm just making a little bit of money here and there, however I can, so that I can get some sneakers and clothes.
Yeah.
So that the girls can like me.
Oh, there you go. It was all about
that
girls.
That was it.
Yeah. So you eventually moved up.
Eventually I moved up. I would say that I started selling more drugs and how many years? I would say about 10.
10 years.
10 years later, I really got involved deep into selling drugs.
You were dealing more with the distribution side, not being in the crack house.
Right. Right. Correct.
Yeah. You were dealing to dealers.
Yes.
Fair to say?
Yeah. You can say that.
Okay. So, take me to the day that you finally got arrested for being in that world. Tell me that day.
You want me to describe what happened?
Yeah, tell me that day. How did that go down?
So I was with a friend, and I received a phone call.
Yeah.
And the person said, hey, listen, you know, I want this and this much and of this, and I said, no, I'm not going to do that. I just didn't want to. I was really comfortable where I was at. I was far away. I didn't want to do it. So then I hung up the phone. And at the time, I was...
What year was this?
This was 2006, I believe.
2006.
And I was with a girlfriend of mine at the time. And so I told her, listen, somebody's calling me. She knew the lifestyle I was living, and she was okay with it. And I told her, listen, somebody just called me, and it was kind of weird. He never calls me, and he asked me for a large amount than he usually does.
Yeah.
And I said, but I'm not gonna go. And she said, okay. Then I get another phone call from somebody that he knew, and that person called me, and they asked me for something, and I said, no, I'm not going out there. I already told your associate I'm not gonna do it. Why are you calling me? So I started to get a little suspicious, but then another part of me was telling me, nah, maybe you're just being paranoid.
Yeah.
So then I told my girlfriend at the time, and I said, listen, I told her, I explained the situation. I'm like, if it was really a setup, would they be calling me so much? And I was like, probably not. And then I remember clearly that she said, well, that's not necessarily so.
Yeah.
And I said to her, well, I didn't really pay mind to her. I was just like, she doesn't know what she's talking about. Mm-hmm. This is what I do. And I had that like cocky mentality, and I was just like, I'm just gonna go do it.
Yeah.
I'm gonna make my, I need this money, I'm gonna go get it.
Yeah.
And I figured that this would be a good opportunity to make a lot of money in that time and just sit back mm-hmm. and not have to deal for a while.
Yeah.
Because it was gonna be a good sale. And I was getting ready to leave, and I something just said, in a eerie kind of joking way, I was like, look, this may be the last time I may see you in a while. Let me just give you the last hug and kiss. And she's like, no, don't say that. And it turned out that that's
what happened.
That's what ended up happening, yeah.
So you go to the sale. You knew something was fishy.
Okay, yeah. And I went there. I drove over there. I had the drugs on me. Mm-hmm. And and I was thinking to myself, first, they're like, oh, come over here. And I'm like, no, I'm not going over there.
Mm-hmm.
That was kind of fishy.
Yeah.
I was like, no, you go where I tell you to go.
Yeah.
And they're like, all right, fine. Where do you want us to go? And then I said, go to this location. I said, no problem. So I went over there. Then I noticed somebody was in a car parked where they clearly weren't supposed to. And where I was at, people don't normally park in areas they're not supposed to.
You were in a parking lot in a mall, right?
I was in a parking lot in a mall. And so I look inside the car just to see who it was, and they knew I was very close, and I purposely kind of looked to see their reaction. They didn't look at me, nothing. And mm-hmm. automatically I was like, oh, wait a minute, something's up here.
Yeah.
Average person would look at me and
yeah.
probably even give me a look like, why are you looking at me?
Acknowledge.
They didn't budge, and I was like, this is not a good sign.
Know.
It's
yeah.
probably a cop.
Yeah.
Or worse, DEA or.
Yeah.
So the guy calls me. He says, hey, is that you in the Impala? I'm like, hey, whoa, wait a minute. You know, mm-hmm. we're not supposed to talk like that.
Yeah.
So he takes me. He said, oh, I'm sorry. And then he's like, just follow me. I'm in this car. And I said, okay. And I just hung up quickly. Then in my mind, I'm like, I should maybe just drop the drugs and mm-hmm. and meet him up and then come back and pick up the drugs. But then I'm like, nah, I'm being paranoid.
Yeah.
So I follow him. Next thing you know, I get pulled over.
Yeah.
By a regular police officer in the area. And I'm like, apparently they were trying to make it seem like it wasn't like a
bust. Regular traffic stop.
They were trying to make it seem like a regular traffic stop.
Yeah.
And that's what I got. I got the sense. Because it all came together too perfectly. And I was like, this is a setup. So as soon as I pulled over, they're like, get out the car. I'm like, this is not how you treat a regular traffic stop. Mm-hmm. This is not how you approach it.
Yeah.
So I already knew, and they're like, so you have anything in the car? And I'm like, no. And they're like, whoa, what, do you have any past convictions? And I said, no, but I was arrested for attempted murder one time. And he said, oh, so now we have to search your car. So now, supposedly they had a legitimate reason to search my car.
Yeah.
He pats me down, and I had a knife in my pocket. It was actually a box cutter. Mm. He says, oh, now we have to take you in because you have a box cutter.
Mm.
Which I knew it was BS, but mm-hmm. I was like, all right, whatever. I just went along with it because
it was like you wanted to get caught.
Actually, a part of me wanted to get caught. A part of me was like, I was just tired of this lifestyle.
You're tired
just,
of it.
It was dirty to me. It got to a point where I'm just like, I'm giving something to people that is destroying their lives, and I didn't want to be a part of that anymore.
You were tired of it.
And I was just tired of it. I'm like, I felt dirty. I didn't like that feeling of feeling dirty. I realized it just wasn't me anymore.
It wasn't you. So they arrest you.
They arrest me.
And what were you charged with?
I was charged with distribution and manufacturing cocaine.
Mm-hmm. And you pled?
I pled guilty.
Yeah. And so they take you off to, so you were in jail, and then they take you off to prison.
Yes, I spent 11 months.
Oh, 11.
In jail, in a county jail. It was a maximum sentence, what they call maximum sentence.
Yeah.
County jail. mm-hmm. and which is like the people who have like the largest cases, mm-hmm. they get sent there, and from there I went to prison.
And how long were you in prison?
After that, I went to prison for another 3 months, so in total 14 months.
Total of 14 months. So what's it like when you get to your first day, I guess, in jail, prison, and you finally get to sit down and you get to look at your life? What do you tell yourself? What was that like? Tell me, paint that picture for me.
Reflecting on my life,
yeah,
and
yeah.
While I'm incarcerated, like yeah. when I first got incarcerated,
yeah. What did you tell yourself?
I told myself, I've been here before.
Yeah.
So this is not anything I can't. I'm not going to be. I can overcome this. I can get through this because I've yeah. been to jail before.
Yeah.
It's not like I was like scared of it or. I wasn't really. I was like. In a way, I was just not sure exactly. Well, actually, no, I'm sorry. I didn't know how much time I was going to do.
Mm-hmm.
But when I first got locked up, I didn't
yeah.
know.
You
so
didn't know.
I was nervous because yeah. I actually got visited by a DEA agent mm-hmm. and while I was in jail. And the DEA agent, he came to me and said, you know, they said, I got a visitor. I'm like, great. And then when I see it, he's like, oh, pulled out his badge. I'm a federal agent, and I'm like, oh great, you know, this is a great visit. It's gonna be a great visit.
Is it like what we see on like Law and Order? Are those visits like that, or is that just a bunch of crap on TV?
Like how describe?
Like
to
when
me
it,
how
when you say you're gonna
exactly
have a visitor, you walk in. Is it like you know? Is it anything like you see on TV?
It kind of was.
It kind of was.
Yeah, they're like, you have a visitor, come to this room. And I'm like, visitor? I'm like, great. I see this guy, mm-hmm. pulls out a badge, and I'm like, oh, great. This is going to be a great visit. I was, mm-hmm. Of course, I'm being sarcastic. And so this guy pulls out his badge, and he tried to intimidate me. You know, pull out. I'm a federal agent.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like,
I'm already in jail.
Yeah,
what are you going to do to me?
I'm like, so what? And he's like, do you know your bail is $100,000? And actually went up to $250,000. I'm like, so what? It'll come down. I'll get out of jail soon.
Hmm.
And then he's like, well, you know, we want you to talk. And I said, okay, well, it's not happening. I have nothing to say to you. Oh, well, really? Well, it turns out that we know about you, and we've actually arrested you before last year. Do you remember that? I said, no, I don't know what you're talking about.
Hmm.
And then after that, he just got frustrated, and he just said, I don't have time for this. And well, he cursed. I didn't want to curse.
Yeah, of course.
He cursed and picked up his badge and he just left. And I thought it was just like he was just playing the role. But
yeah.
And I thought he was going to come back. And they didn't. So I was like, great.
So he didn't.
So I went back to my cell, 23-hour lockdown. And I was just like, wow, this is crazy.
23 hours.
I went, you know, I was showing to him like this is nothing. But when I went back, I was like, oh, my God. DEA, like they're investigating now, and that was in the back of my mind. And at that point, I didn't know what
yeah.
was going to happen.
So, at what point do you say, I really have to turn my life around? Like, I'm not coming back here to prison. Was there a specific moment, or you knew that before you went in?
I knew that. Before I went in, I knew that. Like, I'm not going to do this forever.
Yeah.
I knew that.
Yeah.
At that point when I started feeling dirty doing this,
sure.
I knew that it wasn't anymore about getting money, about getting girls, about going to the club. It was something different that it became to me now. It had just mm-hmm. occurred to me differently.
Okay.
And at that point, I'm like, I'm not going to do this anymore. That was before I got arrested.
So what was the day like when you got out of prison?
When I got out of prison, I was in a white shirt. They give you like a white shirt and jeans, these regular mm-hmm. jeans, no name brand jeans. And I remember just smelling the air and just looking around and just seeing the sky. And it just looked like infinite.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just reflecting on, wow, is this real? Is this real? And my girlfriend at the time brought me clothes. I asked her to bring me clothes. I immediately took off the clothes that they gave me. I put on the clothes that I asked for, specific clothes, and I put those on and I said, let's just get the hell out of here.
Yeah. So I'm going to fast forward a bit. You got involved. What you do now is you eventually moved into being a job developer.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about, for people who are coming out of the prison system like you were, tell me about how that happened.
So when I got out,
yeah,
I met my parole officer, and my parole officer was like, listen, she was very strict. And she's like, she was not playing with me. And she's like, you're going to do this, and you're going to get a job, and this is what's going to happen. I said, no problem. I was not going back to jail. So she said, you're going to go to this program. It's called CEO. And at first, I didn't go. And she said, oh, did you go to your appointment? And I said, what appointment? I didn't know it was mandatory. She says, well, you have to go. And so then I went, and I'm looking around the place, and I'm trying to see what other people are saying. I'm just hearing other people's feedback. Some people were complaining, like, oh, they got me this job. This is I don't like this job, and just complaining. And I'm like, I thought to myself, this is not going to happen to me.
Yeah.
So I met with the job developer. The job developer sits down with me, and he's looking on his computer, and he's like, okay, these are the jobs that I think I can place you in. And he mentioned some labor jobs, and I'm like, no, it's not going to happen. And he said, okay, so then what job do you want to do? And I said, well, I want to do your job, actually. And then he said to me, oh, you think you could do my job? And I said, actually, I know I can do your job. And you know, I had a cocky attitude back then, and he just looked at me, and he's like, all right, we'll see. And he went to get another job developer, and which turned out to be a really good job developer who had a really great reputation in the field.
Yeah.
And I went to her, and I said, she said, oh, I heard you can, you think you could be a job developer? And I said, yeah, I can do that. She set me up with a job interview. A month later, I'm a job developer.
So what do you do? What is it? What's your first person you helped get a job?
First person.
Nutshell it.
The first person that came to me for a job, this guy had like aggravated assault and robbery, and I'm like, oh great, my first client, and
yeah,
I'm supposed to place this guy who has robbery, and I'm like, where am I going to place somebody with robbery and assault? This is not going to be easy, and so. Then I thought about some places, and I ended up placing him in a moving company. He was happy, and I was just like, wow, it was amazing.
Wow.
I felt like on top of the world. It was great.
Very good.
And it was on the books.
On the books?
Which was part of the requirement.
Yeah. Had to be an on-the-books job.
Yeah. They have to get on-the-books jobs. Yeah.
And so you've done lots of jobs like that. So you helped a lot of different people. And
yes.
Now tell us what you do.
So now I'm currently a workforce development instructor at the Green Career Center with the Osborne Association.
Yes.
And I instruct classes on professionalism, on communication, interpersonal skills, and environmental literacy. That's why they call it the Green Career Center.
I got it. What's the biggest obstacle that you have in dealing with people who come to your classes?
The most challenging thing working with people who've been incarcerated?
Yeah.
I think the most challenging thing is being able to get through past the layers that they put up, or the guard that they put up, or a certain act that they put up, and being able to get to the core of who they are. And that's a challenge because they have many barriers that they're faced with.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, it's getting through. I imagine it's interrupting that conversation that they have about themselves and who they are.
Yeah. Actually, it is how they perceive themselves. That's a big part of it, actually.
Yeah. And now you have a letter you wanted to share with us.
Yeah.
Can you want to share that with us?
Yeah, I wanted to share.
Who is this?
This is a participant. I don't want to say his name
to respect his
identity, but so this is an email that I received from a participant who he was in my class, and part of the training is like public speaking and communication, and so whenever he was in class, he spoke like this, very low, and so I coached him on it, and I told him, like, speak to the wall and project your voice, and so he sends me like He completed successfully the training, and so he sent me a letter a few weeks later, maybe, or almost a month or two. I don't remember exactly, but he says, Mr. Gavilanes, good morning. I'm reaching out just to thank you again for the training and empowerment I gained from you. Yesterday, for the first time in my life, I did public speaking in Washington, D.C. at a conference I attended with Vocal New York. And another participant who was in the training with him, he said that he was present, and he stated that I spoke clearly and I projected my voice properly where everyone could hear me. Mm-hmm. You are an awesome coach. Have a blessed day. And when I read that, I was just like, wow, it's amazing. Yeah. Because I've never even spoken in Washington, D.C.
Wow.
And one of my students is speaking in Washington, D.C. Mm. And took my coaching on.
Yeah.
And he was very proud of it. I'm very proud of him. It was amazing to know that I could make a difference in someone's life like that. It was just like unbelievable.
Yeah. When you look back on your life, especially your earlier life, what do you say to the families or the people whose family members you sold drugs to? When you look back on that, what do you think now?
It's terrible when I think about it. I remember there was this one person that I sold to, and I remember that his wife yelled at me one time on the phone, like, stop selling my husband drugs and get out of our lives. And at the time I was just like, oh, this lady's crazy, because she was doing the drugs too. But then now, thinking back, I was just like, wow, I played a part in maybe destroying that person's life or that marriage, and I feel really bad about it.
Yeah,
it's not a good feeling at all to have on my. It's not something good at all to have on my conscience.
Yeah, and then when you have letters like this, it makes all the difference.
Yeah.
So what are your list of accomplishments? What have you accomplished now since then?
I love that question.
By the way.
Because I'm very proud of what I've accomplished since I've gotten out of prison. And one of them is I received a scholarship to a drug counselor program through a CUNY school, which I received college credits, and I received the educational requirement to receive what's called a CASAC to be a drug counselor. Mm-hmm. Also, I was on the dean's list twice. 2 years in a row at Lehman College. I have a 3.9 GPA now. I've also been quoted on the Huffington Post. And that's something else I'm proud of. Working with people who've been formerly incarcerated.
Okay. Well, I want to thank you so much for taking the time to share your story with us. And what you and I created was that this would have a positive impact on our communities. So I want to thank you once again for coming and sharing your story. And this has been Up for Discussion. And tune in again sometime soon. Thank you.